Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cohen, and I'm the Executive Director of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York in Bayside, Queens. Our mission is to use the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. Today's talk is entitled Weaponizing the Past, German Fascism in the 20th Century, and features Drs. Aliza Atik and Kathleen Alves, both Associate Professors of English at Queensborough Community College and the 2023-24 KHC National Endowment for the Humanities Faculty Fellows. They'll be in conversation today about the cultural rhetoric of German greatness surrounding anti-Jewish legislation and violence immediately prior to the start of World War II, using clips from the film Good Morning Hitler, which was produced in 1993 and which captures footage from the 1939 German Arts Festival, a mass celebration in Munich, Germany, in honor of 2,000 years of German culture that took place 6 weeks before the war's outbreak. The Kupferberg Holocaust Center in Bayside, New York, is situated on the traditional land of the Mantinecock people who continue to live here today. We offer gratitude and respect to all of the indigenous people of Turtle Island, past, present, and future, including the Lenape and Shinnecock peoples. What I just read is what we call a land acknowledgement. This is a statement recognizing that the land we all occupy in the course of our daily lives, including our schools, jobs, parks, and homes, as well as the names of towns and roads, was first inhabited by another group of people who were forcibly expelled and murdered. Today, we identify those crimes for what they are: mass atrocities and genocide. These horrors continue to have devastating political, social, psychological, economic, and environmental impacts upon and within Native American and Indigenous communities. Today's event kicks off the 2023-24 KHC and NEH colloquium entitled Weaponizing the Past: Art, History, and the Rhetoric of National Greatness. The event is organized by the KHC and is co-sponsored by the Ray Walpole Institute for the Study of the Holocaust, Genocide, and Crimes Against Humanity at Western Washington University, the Holocaust and Human Rights Center in White Plains, and the Center for the Study of Genocide and Human Rights at Rutgers University. And one final note, after the presentation, please be sure to submit your questions via the Q&A button, which you'll find at the bottom of your screen. And now to kick things off, please join me in welcoming this year's 2023-24 KHC-NEH Faculty Fellows, Dr. Kathleen Alves and Dr. Aliza Atik. Dr. Kathleen Tamayo Alves is Associate Professor of English at Queensborough Community College. Her research centers on 18th century literature and culture, medicine and literary history, and she has recently published for studies in 18th century culture, 18th century fiction, Alpha Ben Online, and The Rambling. Her book in progress, Body Language, Medicine and the 18th Century Comic Novel, currently under review at Bucknell University Press, explores how medicine shaped and is shaped by comic language through fictional dramatizations of female-specific medical phenomena, such as menstruation, hysteria, and pregnancy. Dr. Aliza Atik is also Associate Professor of English at Queensborough Community College, and her research focuses on the discourses of power, violence, and marginalization. She has published on the functioning of affect and emotion in Israeli cinema and on the pedagogy of teaching about mass violence and genocide. Dr. Atik co-organized the 2016-27 KHC-NEH colloquium entitled Fleeing Genocide, Displacement, Exile, and the Refugee. She was also an accepted seminar participant in the 2019 Jack and Anita Hess Faculty Seminar at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum titled Disability, Eugenics, and Genocide: Nazi Germany, Its Antecedents, and Legacy. Dr. Atik teaches classes on literature of the Holocaust, popular culture, and literature theory, along with multiple composition courses, and she is currently one of the Queensborough Community College's representatives to the CUNY LGBTQIA+ Council. Dr. Atik and Alves, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Laura. And thank you, everyone, for attending this important event. We are grateful for your time. All right, so Laura already gave a little bit of a summary of the talk for today. So I'm just going to expand on it a little bit. We won't have enough time for the clips and for discussion for Q&A. Speaking of German fascism, Walter Benjamin famously wrote, "The logical outcome of fascism is an aestheticizing of political life. This year-long series of events seeks to explore this notion by examining movements built through the reappropriation of historical memory into a romanticized ideal that requires the exclusion and elimination of ideas and identities. Our touchstone for the series is the German Art Festival held in Munich in March of 1939, just months before the invasion of Poland and in the shadow of years of anti-Jewish legislation in Germany after 1933. This event is captured in the film Good Morning, Mr. Hitler, which features color footage of a public event designed to celebrate 2,000 years of German cultural history and includes interviews with participants of the parade and their retrospective thoughts in their celebration of the German Reich. Using this film as a starting point, we seek to explore how the Nazi Party and other radical movements have utilized the fetishization of the past to violently erase those out of compliance with the retroactive national norm. We examine historical artifacts as representations in visual art, film, and literature, and how the iconography of these ideologies and their eras has found afterlives in neo-fascist coalitions. This resurgence of an ethos that romanticizes the past is not only present in radical circles, but has spread to the legislative branches of government, determining local, state, and national policy. For today, we begin this year's colloquium with a discussion of Good Morning Hitler as a prime example of what Benjamin sees as an aestheticization of political life. We will examine how this film taps into a reappropriation of historical memory that shaped the cultural rhetoric of German greatness, rooted in anti-Jewish legislation and violence. November's forum will feature three guest speakers to discuss the archives of nostalgic American pasts, including memorabilia related to antebellum, post-war affluence, and idealized suburbia. Finally, in December, we invite faculty to explore the challenges of teaching difficult knowledge, complicated, controversial, and emotionally weighted topics in diverse community college classrooms, and how we can navigate these complex learning environments. I am pleased to introduce Dr. Aliza Atik, who will briefly describe the political context of Good Morning Hitler and lead our discussion of the film's impact on German historical memory and the public engagement with the weaponizing of art and history.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that lovely introduction. I'm going to jump right into it. I'd like to share my screen. Just 3 months before the start of the September 1939 invasion of Poland and the official start of World War II, the large art festival took place in Munich with Adolf Hitler and much of the Nazi leadership overseeing a multi-day celebration of 2,000 years of German culture. While it may seem surprising that an art festival was the focus right before the start of a large-scale invasion, art was actually a significant element of the Nazi state apparatus. The concept of Nazification of German culture had been cultivated by the regime. The term Gleichschaltung, right, or coordination, was a fundamental part of creating a Germany aligned under a single worldview, something Joseph Goebbels, the minister for propaganda, understood well. Soon after Hitler's 1933 appointments as chancellor of Germany, and not long after the Reichstag fire and the resulting enabling decree and effective single-party rule, the Nazi government established the Reich Culture Chamber, which then controlled the various Reich chambers of film, music, theater, press, writing, fine arts, and radio. Not only did these institutions disseminate Nazi values, they also helped police and exclude any outsider work. Familiar to many are the state-sponsored brick burnings of 1933. Encouraged by the Nazi German Student Association as part of the national, quote, action against the un-German spirits, culminating in this cleansing by fire. Similarly, in the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, for example, exists the inventory of more than 16,000 works of art determined by the Nazis to be degenerate. As defined by the Nazis, degenerate art reflected the cultural decline created by modernity inflected with un-Germanic tastes, the supposed immorality of Jewish and communist interests, and cultural Bolshevism. Many of the seized works were later shown in a degenerate art exhibition, which started in Munich in 1937 and later toured the Reich as a reminder for visitors that biological degeneracy and artistic degeneracy were one and the same. And here's a clip or an image of this exhibition. As a result, whether journalistic or artistic, any medium which disseminated ideas was intentionally cultivated to disseminate Nazi values. In this system, the consuming public internalizes and then continues to recursively reproduce Nazi ideals throughout the entire public sphere. Yet, in the same 6 years between 1933 and 1939, the Nazi state pursued its agenda through legal changes in the status to Jewish and other degenerate people, changes which were then enforced through police and military power. These changes include, but were not limited to, and I'm going to put it on the screen here, and while I'm not going to read it off, you can see both exclusions from public space, from the public sphere, right? Kind of the elimination of any influence these un-Germanic voices might have, as well as the criminalization and incarceration of various people, likewise considered un-German influences in the public sphere. Some of these include the building of camps, such as the Buchenwald concentration camp, as well as Dachau, which was right outside of Munich, where this festival was held. It also includes the Nuremberg race laws, which effectively eliminated any rights Jews had as citizens of Germany and allowed for legal violence against their body. And of course, the events of November 9th, 1938, also known as Kristallnacht, the Night of Broken Glass, which was an incredible outburst of street violence, vandalism, and murder of the Jewish population. Looking at these things together, the cultural, the artistic, the stripping of rights, and the emerging violence gives important context to the 1939 celebration of 2,000 years of German culture. The Nazi government and its militant arms produced and enforced laws for the systemic erasure of Jews, Sinti, Roma, and other degenerates from public life and for the protection of the states, and branded them as enemies and legitimate subjects of state-endorsed persecution. And simultaneously, they aestheticized, or perhaps fetishized, a true German culture by insisting on a historical Aryan aesthetic enshrined in German history. In this aestheticized past, a fantasy of Germanic ideals became part of a common culture, became part of politics, and became part of the general worldview. This 1939 festival, however, is especially unique because of a surprising turn of events. By happenstance, a local German film enthusiast, Hans Firebrand, and his film club decided to capture footage of this festival, right? They were not part of the Nazi state. They were just local amateur filmmakers. And this uncensored footage remained in Firebrand's family possession and was shared only with family members for many, many, many years. However, in 1933, Luke Holland and Paul Yu, the producers and directors of these films, used this footage to create what we are about to watch, Good Morning, Mr. Hitler. In it, Holland and Yule use the direct, unscripted, unedited footage captured by this film club to show scenes of not only the events, but also screenings for the original participants who participated in this national festival, reminiscing as they watch. And this is juxtaposed alongside commentary from historians, as well as Charlotte Knobloch, who was a Jewish woman who lived at the same time of these participants. These experiences under Nazism were decidedly different and show the great disparity in the cultural experience of Germany at that time. As we watch these selections from Good Morning, Mr. Hitler, we want you to consider some of the following things, which we will revisit at the end of the screening. How is Nazi ideology embedded in the aestheticization of German historical greatness? How are art and culture being used to mediate rhetoric of belonging and exclusion? And how are art and history weaponized to justify the ideology of a regime? And how is this normalized through public spectacle and artistic celebration? So I'd like to begin our screening of this footage so we can take a look at these clips together. And then at the end, we'll come back to these questions as well as any audience questions that might that anyone might have.
This remarkable, newly discovered footage, which we see here in such vivid color, was shot in Munich in July 1939, just 6 weeks before the outbreak of the Second World War.
Had a special importance in the National Socialist movement. That's where it began. And Hitler always liked to go back to the place where it all began from, as if he was drawing strength from that memorialization. But it was also the capital of art, in Germany, certainly in his mind. And then the Nazis, I think, strengthened and reinforced that. The date, the 14th of July, is interesting because by a remarkable coincidence, it was to the day 150 years since the storming of the Bastille in 1789, which inaugurated the French Revolution.
My name is Peter Feierabend, and I'm the son of the amateur filmmaker who made this film. My father was an orthopedic technician by trade. He made artificial arms and legs.
My name is Bernd Feierabend. I live here in Munich, and I've taken over my father's company, which he started in 1932. This film was shot in 1939. It's unique. My father made it and always kept it at home. We would see it as children or with friends of the family, but we never showed it publicly. We were a bit shy, I suppose. But anyway, this film is a very important record of this period of history, and I'm glad that it can now be shown to the public.
My name is Martin Summer. I'm the owner of the Heliopan light filter factory in Grevelfing. Our film club was really quite fun. I was one of the youngest members. And we made films using 8mm, 9.5mm, and 16mm film. Then every week we would show films at the club and criticize each other's work so that we'd improve. Mr. Feierabend was a very active filmmaker, of course, and he seemed to have contacts with the Munich leadership. He had a pass, apparently, and so could film close up in a way that was not possible for ordinary amateurs like us.
He was opposed to Hitler, but you have to understand he was also an enthusiastic filmmaker. And so, as members of the Association of German Amateur Filmmakers, they had all the access that they needed. At the end of the war, he hid this particular film under a pile of wood in the cellar. And from then on, the film was kept at home. Now I've decided that this film should be shown to the public.
Habe ich dran gedacht, diesen Film auch einmal der Öffentlichkeit zugänglich zu machen.
So, this is the only.
So what we are seeing in this colour footage from the summer of 1939 is a three-day weekend festival of art, which was held in Munich, which comprised concerts, dancing in the parks, a major exhibition of Nazi art in the House of Art, and all of this climaxing in a huge, spectacular parade supposedly representing 2,000 years of German art and culture.
My name is Josefa Hamann. I was born and bred in Munich and had the pleasure to be involved in the parade on the day of German art. Well, the fuss started weeks beforehand because everything was being decorated, you know. There were all the preparations to be done. Just imagine, thousands of meters of flags and material and statues. I mean, it was an enormous fuss. It was quite unbelievable. Also, oddly enough, the weather was always wonderful on the days when these parades happened. And people used to call it Hitler weather. It was a glorious day. And a lovely experience, which I've not forgotten to this day, and I'm 70. Officially, it didn't really have anything to do with politics. For us, it was just a beautiful day, a chance to meet people. Also, we were recreating something with all those different costumes, weren't we? We were really happy.
My name is Charlotte Knobloch. I am president of the Jewish community in Munich. I experienced the Nazi period with all of its hardship, and I can still remember it very clearly. It is unbelievable what I'm seeing. These brown uniforms with their swastikas, these black uniforms, these SS uniforms.
Diese schwarzen Uniformen, diese SS Uniformen.
You'd think it was yesterday when you see these people.
Wenn man die Leute sieht.
The people were so enthusiastic. They were completely taken in by all this pomp. And that's the Angel of Peace Fountain. I mean, when you see these pictures, then it's impossible to imagine that so much time has passed, because that fountain looks exactly the same today. The whole city was done up at great expense. It really did live up to its name as the capital city of the movement. It's unbelievable, unbelievable.
Unglaublich.
My God, the great eagle.
Ich heiße Ilse Peitz.
My name is Ilse Peitz. My maiden name is Müller. And my father had a large book and newspaper printing company in the Schellingstrasse. Well, he published Mein Kampf. Well, you know, at that time, everyone joined in so enthusiastically. Everyone got involved, and all this joy released something in us.
Und so viel Freude löst ja auch was aus.
You see, we thought we were heading for a better future.
Festivals of art, which I would say assumed a sort of quasi-sacred significance, were both entertainment but also served ideological and political functions for the regime. It was a way of legitimizing itself, celebrating the achievements of the folk of the German nation. Here we have a smiling Rudolf Hess, who seems to be enjoying the occasion. Yes, and we can see Freiherr von Finck, who raised the funds for financing the Haus der Kunst and was very much instrumental in bringing about this occasion. One of the interesting things in this particular footage that here and there we see some gestures. We see Hitler in a more informal pose. It's very difficult to know what was on his mind, whether he had an inner life at all. Here we have Himmler smiling rather wanly. I think he was rather bored by these sort of proceedings. Himmler's presence in his SS uniform is a reminder of really the sinister side of all of this, because the SS had grown enormously in importance through the 1930s, and Himmler was its organizer.
The Ziel unseres neuen deutschen Kunstschaffens ist ohne Zweifel schon heute erreicht, so wie von dieser Stadt München die Bau künstlerische Gesundung ihre Ausgang nahm, hat hier auch vor drei Jahren die Reinigung eingesetzt auf dem vielleicht noch mehr verwüsteten Gebiet der Plastik und Malerei. Der ganze Schwindelbetrieb einer dekadenten oder gar fast verlogenen Modekunst ist im Durchgebet. Ein anständiges, allgemeines Niveau wurde erreicht.
The climax of this weekend festival of art was a huge parade through the streets of Munich, representing 2,000 years of German culture, reportedly seen by over a million people. Everyone joined in. Everyone joined in. Of course, these great celebrations had a tremendous impact abroad. We have to remember, we're about 6 weeks away from the outbreak of the Second World War. Hitler was planning, had planned since April, had given a directive to his own military to prepare an attack on Poland beginning on the 1st of September. Hitler's strength had increased immensely since the Munich agreements of 1938. 11 million more Germans were in the Reich. Their armaments had grown, their population had grown. They sensed they were on some kind of irresistible way.
Followed the great history of Munich. So it was mainly following the buildings of Ludwig I. The great history of Munich should give background for this Festzug and should demonstrate the rise of the art in Munich again. It should become the Kunststadt der Bewegung, the Hauptstadt, the capital of art in the Nazi Empire. And it was very expansive. There were more than 4,000 people working for this procession, connected with it. One has figured out that they worked for 1,700,000 hours to do all the costumes and all the preparation of this procession.
There were adverts in the papers, and for young people this kind of thing is always exciting, so I applied. Well, just because it was fun. You didn't really realize what you were letting yourself in for, but you applied, you know.
Noch Größe.
Then you were chosen according to height. Short people were not used, of course. The Nordic race was supposed to be shown off. I was always very tall, and luckily I was blonde as well, so I was selected. Then I had to go to dance school to learn how to walk properly, and then off we went.
I'm Inge Ungewitter. I'm a painter doing portraits and animals, and I'm a horsewoman. People like Feste, and especially Munich. In Munich, they're always parties who involve many, many people, like Oktoberfest, like Fasching, etc. I was asked if I wanted to go in this procession with a horse on a Fest of Deutsche Kunst. Well, of course, I said, yes, it's interesting, yeah. And I was a Valkyrie, that was a costume. Iron pieces around my breast and iron head with wings on it. And I had in one hand, I had a, how do you say, a Speer, and the other a shield. I had a very interesting horse, and it was a horse with a lot of life in it. And so I had to watch it that this iron didn't trickle me and that everything went in order. My mother said, my God, they decorate all the streets and I'm trying to buy a pack of nails. I can't get a pack of nails in the whole city. There aren't any. They're all gone. They're all somewhere in some garista and Mauern and sheets and things. Of course, I saw there were many, many people watching it, yes. It's like Carnival in Venedig. It was very, very precious.
Jewish community when this was going on?
I don't know. I haven't the slightest idea. I don't know.
That's how it was. When people met up, gangs would form. And if they happened to see a Jew, they would simply beat them up.
Juden gesehen haben, dann haben sie den halt zusammengeschlagen.
It was a situation you cannot imagine. You cannot imagine the kind of terror that people live with.
Ich vorstellen kann, in welcher Angst die Leute gelebt haben. Es ist einfach für mich.
Really, I can't imagine that people could be so happy here. When only 25 kilometers away, 20 kilometers away, was a Dachau concentration camp which was already packed full of people who had broken no laws.
Mit Menschen, die nichts verbrochen haben, die nur wegen ihrer Rasse oder wegen ihrer.
They were put behind barbed wire and tortured simply because of their race or the way they looked.
Und gequält werden. Es ist unglaublich.
It is unbelievable.
No,
a Jew wouldn't have dared go anywhere near all this.
I think, you know, we picked the clips very selectively. This is a 51-minute long documentary, and we can make the full length to the documentary available for the semester. And it's absolutely fascinating. And again, this is one of the few examples of like unedited, not propaganda-oriented footage. So it gives us really interesting insight into how the events and this moment was experienced by all of its participants, whether they were there for celebratory purposes, whether they were there just because this was going on, right? And it was like the big thing in Munich and like, you know, fear of missing out, right? You want to participate in these kinds of events. And of course, as Charlotte Knoblocker talks about, what it meant to be a Jewish person in Germany at that time, right before the outbreak of World War II. So I'd like to open this up for questions, which can be typed into the Q&A chat. And I guess we can start off from there. Yeah.
First, thank you, Aliza and Kat, for selecting not only this film, but putting on specific clips. I was really, really moved and sort of taken with the dichotomy of everyday life, or not dichotomy, because there's three parts to this, the everyday life for German citizens, everyday life and the deprivation of life and rights for Jewish citizens of Germany, and also the iconography of fascism. And I'm thinking a lot about our contemporary society right now in terms of inclusion and exclusion. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about some of these themes in the film and why it's so important for us to look at this as a historical document, but also through the lens of now.
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. Let me, I guess, first tackle the first part, which was this event itself, and then we can kind of transition that to the kind of contemporary moment that we find ourselves in, right? One of the reasons that we wanted to show this film was to demonstrate this alignment that the deprivation of civil legal rights went hand in hand with creating an ideology that kind of supported the deprivation of these rights by establishing kind of a unified worldview. So the more people were being deprived of their rights, that in and of itself, right, when someone no longer have rights, it becomes easier to naturalize them as people undeserving of rights, right? And that's something we see over and over again, and something we can also talk about in our contemporary moment. But likewise, art and culture are also part of this same agenda, and they're not separable from one another. And I think the fact that these kinds of legislative gestures and legal gestures took place alongside the establishment of kind of this idea of like Nazification, right? The synchronized culture, I think, is really telling, because you have to create an ideology that doesn't just accept these things, but is excited. Right. And so when you create this, essentially this Germanic ideal that pervades every part of culture, right, not just in the newspapers, but just, you know, streets, museum, film, radio, all the areas where consumption can happen, right, it coincides with this legal process, and it just, everything becomes normalized, right? The law exists now as kind of, it becomes almost like common sense, right? It creates at least a fiction of common sense, because it establishes this idea, and this is the power of nostalgia, of it has always been this way, right? So if I use art and I talk about this 2,000-year-old history of this arch, and of course, this 2,000-year-old history, while it is cultivated, it's cultivated through the Nazi racial lens, it again creates this normalization that makes these laws seem like they too are part of these this 2,000-year-old history, right? It erases Jewish participation in the German nation across these 2,000 years, the undesirable participation in the German nation across these 2,000 years, and makes it seem that the nostalgia is for a time where it has always already been this way. And so I think we can look at that certainly into our contemporary political moments. The thing that jumps up into me is certainly talking about books, literature that is being made available in the public sphere, and the push to, and again, the same thing, right? This at the same time eliminates things like critical race theory to erase kind of particular forms of history and also naturalize books, literature that don't tell these uncomfortable stories, but instead kind of work together with the banning of like historical teaching to create a naturalized ideology of it, or fantasy, I should say, of it, these people who are excluded from these stories, it has always been this way. And I don't know, Dr. Alves, if you'd like to jump in on that as well.
I don't have really much to add except to, we're going to continue the idea of, or this pattern of book banning, and we can, later on this term, especially in regards to how the purging of 3 years from this festival was to cleanse the German state with degenerate art, right? And that's been sort of the same kind of rhetoric that any mention or any presence of LGBTQI themes, especially in, young people's libraries or in the schools, is considered to be inappropriate and, degenerate in that sense. But I would like to go to the Q&A, if that's okay with you, Aliza and Laura. So we have an interesting question. This was about decency. So why all the naked statues? Good question.
I mean, decency is always in the eye of the beholder, right? And so part of the movement of propaganda is to define what is decent. Naked body, right? Especially built to the Germanic ideal. And one of the clips that I did not include was very much, it was rooms full of naked statues, very Nordic looking, very muscular, very much positioned in this kind of military poses, right? And that was to aestheticize this particular like Aryan ideal. So decency wasn't defined via nudity, it was defined against Aryanization. And so degenerate art often, for example, depicted no nudity, but it may have depicted an idea or a concept that then was framed as indecent, and therefore the people producing it themselves were indecent.
Right. And I don't know if it's, I'm not thinking really of ideal, but more of normative, right? Even if somebody fit the Aryan model of, a person, if that person had any kind of disability, they would not fit into that model. And so it was a reflection of what I think the Nazi state was holding up as normal. I mean, you heard that one participant who had to go through what almost sounds like a modeling, test. She went to some kind of conduct school just to learn how to walk, just to be in this parade. And so it was a highly orchestrated, highly curated spectacle for the public.
And again, speaks to this idea of representation, right? Bodies that are continuously represented are the bodies normalized.
Right. And that reminds me of that one particular statue, I can't remember now, which was held up as the ideal female body, and and it was later revealed that the sculptor was an Asian woman. And so it just the representations of art and the intent behind art can be so malleable to fit whoever's and whatever's ideology. Okay, so the next question. This is from our colleague Susan Jakubowicz. Germany has a long history, but the Germanic peoples were not a united national for thousands of years. And this is a similar answer, a question from Danielle Brooke. The modern nation state came in 1866. Do you think a country with a shorter history is more at risk of feeling that they need to embrace a kind of fake past? Boy, oh boy.
Easy question. Again, the idea of a nation state and the idea of, I think part of Hitler's philosophy or Nazi philosophy was to kind of not define Germany necessarily as a nation state, but as a concept, right? As a system of values, as a group of people, right? As an ethnic identity, essentially, that was traced back to 2000 years. And in doing so, he created this, I guess, retroactive fantasy, right, of Germany itself. It's hard to measure risk, certainly, but I would say it perhaps creates an opening because there is always an interest in creating a national fantasy and a national fantasy that needs to be understood as inevitable, right, in order for a nation state to function. So it has to be based on like some kind of ideological history, applied retroactively, but it needs to be there in order to generate enthusiasm from citizens for the nation state. And so while I wouldn't necessarily measure risk factor, because this can also take place, right? Pasts can be idealized or romanticized in any country at any point in time, right? There just has to be, as we're seeing here, intention as well as the power to implement that intention. So I wouldn't say one naturally leads to the other, but it creates an opening or a possibility, or maybe it creates a need.
Sure. And, I think we can draw from several examples. We can start with Reconstruction, right? The very idea and the name of the antebellum erases the horrors of enslavement, right? That era was somehow better, but better for who? Better for whom? Let's take another question. Jackie Silver asks, was there ever any propaganda footage from the same event that people looked at to compare with this footage? I actually had a similar question, and I'm not sure if you can answer this, Aliza or Laura, but I just found it incredibly unsettling, the amount of the vibrancy of the color of this footage with just, and then the participants who recalled their memories as we were all happy that they were that it was a release of joy. What did you think about that?
About the propaganda footage? Yes, there was. I think I don't have access to it, but anything that was done by the Nazi apparatus was then utilized, newsreels, for example, film, press, that could be an interesting addendum to this conversation or a project, perhaps for a class, a history class, to kind of go and look into the archives and do this kind of comparative analysis. But I think the interesting thing, and perhaps this is an assumption, is that the propaganda footage would still, I think, have the same essence of what we saw here. Right? The joy, the framing of the Nazi leadership, right? The flags, the color, the showmanship. Mm-hmm. The thing I think that's interesting about here is more the close-up of some of the leaders, mm-hmm. Some of these unscripted moments by Hitler that you wouldn't see in the propaganda footage. Some of the massive Nazi officials kind of sitting there and looking relaxed and looking casual and just kind of inhabiting that, this is what we do. This is our career. This is our job. This is how we, kind of are participating in our work. Right. It's like another event that they had to go to and a chance to also socialize. Right. You see the socialization, you see everybody dressed up. And so I think those unscripted moments are really interesting for us. But I think the tenor of the propaganda would be similar, maybe with some more intense music behind it, right? So various rhetorical strategies to frame it heroically. But I would imagine that it wouldn't be a huge contrast.
Let me see. So Brian Bendel asks, do you think based on this historical event that it was unique and could have been a different Hitler if this didn't happen in the time it took place or later? So if I'm understanding Brian properly, I wonder if he's asking if this was, or they're asking if this was an inevitable thing, right? That if it wasn't going to be Hitler, it would have been someone else like Hitler, sort of, you know, emerging from the aftermath of the First World War and, you know, the depression that took over the rest of the world thereafter.
I mean,
I'm asking an impossible question. Like, do you think it was inevitable?
I think it's a great question, actually. And I think it speaks to the point of what we do here, which is it happens because it can happen, right? Mm-hmm. It happens not just in Nazi Germany, but anywhere in which people interested in seizing power use the tools to do so, right? And what we're seeing, and part of why I like to do this, is to recognize the way in which these patterns appear. And we usually find, in terms of the way fascism functions, that creating this nostalgia for a past ideal is usually one of the common denominators. And so I think that's actually a great question, because the whether or not this one particular outcome was inevitable, it's impossible to answer. But the patterns through which genocide and mass violence occur, through which fascism guides people to genocide and mass violence, those are repeated patterns. I remember a couple of years ago, we had Janet Mirkatetti, who is a survivor from Rwanda, come and speak at the center. And she said something that lives with me today. And she said, whenever, because somebody in the audience had asked her during a Q&A, I don't understand here, like in Rwanda, despite, you know, small tribal differences, there was no ethnic difference, there was no religious difference, there was no racial difference. So what was it that drove this genocide in which over a million people were murdered by their neighbors, right? Like, it's a very brutal experience. And she said, whenever people in power are interested in creating divisions between people in order to secure their own power, they will find a way to do so. And they will use these techniques that have worked historically over and over again.
And just to circle back to the idea of art, I think that something that's emphasized and seen as, you know, regurgitated back into the cycle of discourse, especially fascist discourse, is the weaponizing of affect, right? That emotion itself can be such an important tool, even in the face of logic and reason. The pathos of any kind of fascist argument is just so much stronger and seems, especially in the last few years, seems absolutely immovable and immutable.
Yes, I think that's essential.
I also just want to mention that earlier this spring, the KHC collaborated with some colleagues and we screened the German concentration camp factual survey, which is footage that the Allied forces took as they were liberating the concentration camps. And if we look at that footage in tandem with what we saw in this particular film, I think one of the things that we just assume, and maybe this is also of our generation and the generation before us, is that the pictures in the video don't lie. And we're moving into the realm of AI, where all kinds of footage can not only be manipulated, but made to such a degree that it feels real. Even I've been following an organization called Witness, and they talk about how you can manufacture images of, let's say, peacekeepers or people who are committing atrocities at the moment, even though none of this is actually grounded in reality. And I think this is something that we as people moving in this culture need to start recognizing, that the imagery around us might start not only to lie, but be manipulated to a point that convinces us mm-hmm. a reality that doesn't exist. And I also just want to mention one other thing, which is, you know, for those of you in the audience that have been to, let's say, Munich very much vibrates with this architecture of the past, and going into these buildings and going into museums, everything was created by the Nazis to have a very specific feel. And in another trip, we went to Dachau. So I started off the morning at the concentration camp, and then we went into the town, and the town feels like a classically German place. And the day ended with a celebration of Baroque music at the castle on the hill. And it was amazing to me to watch German citizens navigating these different levels of reality and history. And then as a Jewish person being there saying, well, this festival is really lovely, but not too far away from here is Dachau. And this is also used from a tourist perspective to bring people into the town. So there's all these different ways that the history is colliding with the present. And I just wanted to turn it both back over to you both, if you have any, want to answer any additional questions or reflect.
I notice also a question about the youth and the youth participation in this mm-hmm. event. And yes, I think that is a very important observation. Another facet to the unification of German culture were things like the Nazi youth, which gave, you know, people a chance to once again participate in culture in a way that was fun, in a way that was communal, and a way that once again reproduced and normalized the values of the Nazi state. And so I think that youth is important. And again, it makes, as many of these participants looked back on this film nostalgically, like, oh, wow, that was a really fun day. Like, we were having a great time. And that one moment, which I hope you guys caught, of where were the Jewish people during that time? And the answer was, I don't know. I didn't think about it. I really didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
I thought mm-hmm. that was like a really powerful moment. And I think specific to how you bring up children via ideology to create a state that then functions according to ideology.
Right. And I'm just thinking about other kinds of with what Laura has mentioned with, you know, other kinds of spectacle and technology, the last string of, you know, anti-Semitic, anti-Black shootings have had, you know, shooters with ties and investment in the dark internet, you know, that they just have this enclave of distressingly racist ideology. And, you know, it's just been happening over and over again. And if you're a historian, I mean, I'm not a historian, but if you're a literature professor who studies history, it's really quite astonishing and sometimes demoralizing how the cycle, but in a different form, right? How it's now reconfigured with just unmanageable areas of the internet or even social media that is very much beyond our control. Can we just answer one more question by one of my students, Stephen? He asked, with the recent news of the WGA strike concluding today, do you feel that AI will be restricted and laid back on documentaries discussing political topics like fascism?
I don't know.
Absolutely not.
I don't think so either.
The AI universe is coming. There's a lot of really important human rights organizations that are all over this. I would say in the next few years, the transition to an alternate reality that we literally cannot detect is coming. And, you know, it's definitely an area to explore and to learn as much as you can about.
I actually also see one interesting question that I'd like to address right before we wrap up, which was, is by Jung Chin. And it's about the way in which Nazis or Nazi race ideology was influenced by the United States. And the answer is yes, very much so. As were their ideas about eugenics, which were very much influenced by American race scientists. And there's a lot of deep research on that. Eugenics in the Garden is a book. I'm not recalling the author's name right now, but that's a great place to start if you're interested in looking at this history. But yes, very much so. And I think when we talk about erasure, right, the fact that most people don't know that about American history also speaks to, like, you know, the way in which narratives and what is taught and what literature and books and ideas we are able to access are very important in understanding what we believe to be true. Kind of like our epistemological history is very much coming from a kind of hierarchical place where we are taught in schools. Schools are sponsored by the states, and we are taught what we are taught. And most of us just kind of build that into our worldview.
Right. And I think it's also important to remember this. And thank you to Jung for pointing this out, in that, you know, especially when the argument is made that, you know, it happened in the past, why can't you move on? The ramifications of enslavement is incredible, right? Far reaching and global. And so, you know, for it to just be isolated as a national or even local issue is, I think, really not the way to look at it. So should we wrap up here? I know we're over time.
Yeah. And I mean, I think that what you're pointing out, though, is really very important, because also sort of in this context, we're used to looking at footage of World War II and the Nazis. And so this is part of our historical memory, but we do not apply the same lens at all in the United States at all. Mm-hmm. And when we're talking, the reason we start off our presentations with a land acknowledgement isn't just for lip service, but mm-hmm. is to educate people, because our country is founded on genocide. And mm-hmm. often it is very difficult to make these links. It's almost as if we talk about anti-Semitism as the ultimate hatred. And yes, I'm Jewish, and it's very much of a concern. And, you know, that's a separate conversation, but it is possible to hold more than one memory at a time. It is possible to say that these different kinds of discrimination are all interlinked. And if it is preventing us as human beings from existing and coexisting with one another, then I think that the challenge we have as we move into sort of this next political era is to be able to hold on to our mutual humanity. Whether we agree with who other people are or not is not really the point. The point now is to find these bonds and strengthen them as civil society if we are to push back on the kind of fascist tendencies and very deeply problematic politics that are happening. So I'd like to turn it back over to both of you if you have any final closing thoughts.
I mean, I don't think so. Thank you so much to everyone who attended. The film will be available in its entirety. We will be sending out a link, and we will also send out a link for this talk with closed captions for those that need it for accessibility. So thank you. And thank you, Dr. Atik, for your wonderful presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Alves. And, you know, just to say, we're doing this for this fall and spring semester. So we want to build on this talk, right? This talk was just the beginning of exploring what Laura just mentioned, right? Kind of the erased histories that we really need to bring into common conversation. So I'm really glad to see participation today, and I hope to see participation at our future events as well. Thank you all for sharing your time with us. It means a lot. So thank you.
Yes. And in November, we will specifically be discussing American history. So it'll be a little bit closer to home in November. So we hope to see you there. Tell your friends. And come.
Thank you, Dr. Atik. Thank you, Dr. Alves. And I also just wanted to point out that the film will be made available to QCC students. For members of the general public, you can access the film on a various number of streaming services. And on behalf of the Kupferberg Holocaust Center and our colleagues here at Queensborough Community College, thank you so much for attending today. We hope you stay safe and be well. Thank you.